my viewers will probably remember when I came out with Planet X2 back in 2017. I was fairly proud of the game myself, but it was also extremely limited as far as real-time strategy games go. And then a year later, I worked with a team of people to bring about Planet X3 on the MS-DOS platform. Now, this game offered significantly better gaming experience than the previous one, everything from graphics and sound down to the gameplay itself. And then after that came Petsky Robots and the bajillion conversions of that into other platforms. Well, about a year ago, I was looking to write another game for the Commander X16, and I posted a poll with four different game ideas to see what people wanted the most. One option was a sequel to Petsky Robots, taking that game to the next level. Another option was some sort of jigsaw puzzle game, side-scroller type game, and finally, a sequel to Planet X3. And well, the X3 sequel got the most votes, so that's the concept I decided to go with. And so, I'm going to take you on a journey of how I created the most sophisticated game I have ever created, and possibly even the most complex game ever created on a 6502 processor. But first, I wanted to give a shout out to PCBWay. They have consistently been a sponsor of the Commander X16 project, giving us big discounts on some PCBs and sometimes even free PCBs. And as everyone knows, PCB stands for Printed Circuit Board. So the first thing I wanted to do is just sort of show you a comparison of what I had to work with. X2 ran on a 1 MHz 6502 with 64K of RAM. X3 ran on a 4.77 MHz 8088 with 256K of RAM. And while it had better graphics on the high-end machines, the core of the game was still the same. And so with Planet X16, I was going to have an 8 MHz 6502 with 512K. And by the way, a 6502 is much more cycle efficient than an 8088, so if we really wanted to compare with the 8088, I suspect this would be like running a 20 MHz 286 or maybe better. So the point is, I could certainly afford to expand the expectations of the game a bit, but another crucial element is the control method. So the previous two games were keyboard controlled since mice were not common on those target systems. Well, every X16 ships with a mouse, so I figured mouse control made total sense here, and I'll circle back to this in a minute. The first thing I wanted to do was get to work on a map editor, and I figured I could probably reuse much of the original VGA artwork from Planet X3. Now, this is what the original tile set looked like. It was 256 tiles that included both landscape and sprites, like the tanks and stuff. This is also one of the reasons, if you look at Planet X3, most of the various units that move around can only face left or right. They don't face up or down. And that's partly because I didn't have a lot of tile space left. So what I wanted to do here was split that up into two different sets, thus giving me more freedom both for map objects and sprites. And so that's potentially 512 tiles now. But one big problem was that the original tile set was in 256 colors, and I needed to down-convert it to 16 colors. Now, while the Commander can actually do 256 colors, one problem is available video RAM, which is 128K. Ideally, I need to be able to store 512 tiles along with a bitmap graphics layer. The reason for the bitmap layer is that I wanted to have a user interface overlay, much like modern RTS games have. So the RAM requirements for that would be 166K, and well, I just don't have that much video RAM. So I tried to convert the graphics down to 16 colors all at once using various algorithms, but it just looked terrible, as you can see. So instead, just to get started, I just down converted the tiles to 16 shades of gray. That actually didn't look too bad, and I started work on the tile editor and eventually the game. Now my plan was to come back and redo the artwork later to take advantage of a neat feature of the Commander X16, which is that tiles or sprites can select between 16 possible palettes. I did this when I ported Zixit over a while back, as each of the blocks uses a different palette, giving me around 84 unique colors on screen, despite working in 16 color mode.
The problem is that we don't really have a tool designed for down-converting pre-existing graphics into multiple different palettes like that, so it'd be a huge undertaking to convert all of that by hand.
But what ended up happening is I realized if I created a single custom palette that had most of the colors I needed and simply converted one tile at a time to using whatever down-conversion algorithm produced the best results for that tile, then I ended up with a 16-color tile set that didn't look half bad. And over time, I kept tweaking it by hand, so over the course of months, with a little tweak here and a little tweak there, before I knew it, I had a pretty nice looking tile set. And then there was the issue of sprites, so I contracted a pixel artist to take the existing sprites, which are only faced left and right, and create up and down versions of all of those. And on top of that, I really wanted these units to animate, so I also asked for even more sprites so they could animate when they move. And here's what the current sprite sheet looks like. Another thing I asked the artist to do is make me a custom intro screen, and I looked through some of the original storyline art for Planet X3, and I decided this picture here might be good inspiration for the title screen, and this is what he came up with. And so let me go ahead and give you a quick look at the game in action. The first thing you'll probably notice is a more familiar user interface, and the fact that you can control multiple units at a time. And of course, smooth pixel-by-pixel movement. Also, we have a fantastic musical soundtrack written just for this game by Nico1690.
I want to talk just a little bit about pathfinding. This has been one of the biggest criticisms I've gotten with games like this in the past. And maybe not even criticism is the right word, but just constant suggestions of how I could improve the pathfinding using this or that algorithm. And unfortunately, the vast majority of people saying things like that, I just don't think they have a grasp of the limitations that I'm having to deal with on an 8-bit computer. Now, I have no doubt you could probably run something like A-Star Pathfinding or some variant of that on an 8-bit computer. The problem is I do not believe you could run that sort of pathfinding multiplied by 256 simultaneous instances. I mean, it's just not going to happen.
So taking a look at the previous game, Planet X3, the individual units had to be driven by hand using the cursor keys, so pathfinding for the player units wasn't really that big a deal. I mean, about the only time it mattered was, for example, if you told your builder to construct a building somewhere on the screen, it would need to drive to the location to execute the command. And while this worked most of the time, every now and then the terrain was too complex and you'd have to help it out some. The real concern was always making sure that the enemy units could find your base.
However, since this version was going to be mouse-controlled, I realized that the pathfinding was going to play a much bigger role with the player units, and so I spent like 2 weeks trying to develop the best pathfinding algorithm I could, given the constraints of the system. And so I want to show you a little bit about how that works.
So imagine a crazy maze like this, and you want to tell your unit to go to the top. Now, a modern real-time strategy game would be able to plot a course through this, but that's just not going to happen on my game. And part of the problem is, while the solution to this maze looks obvious to us humans, the actual units can't see that far. In fact, to kind of illustrate what they see, it looks more like this. So the tank sees a rock above it, and it knows that its destination is over there, for example. So it can make the best choice possible, which in this case is to go right. So the unit does not have a pre-plotted course to follow, and it has no memory of past moves. But what it does know is how far it has traveled from the original location, and how many detours it's had to take. Now this can help it decide a few things. So let me show you some examples of pathfinding. I'm going to tell this tank to move to the other side of this building. And as you can see, it has no trouble with that. In fact, one thing I'd like to point out is that it doesn't always take the same path. Sometimes it goes above and sometimes below. I actually added in a certain amount of randomness to the decision-making process when it encounters an obstacle, which actually helped a surprising amount. Now let's give it a bit longer path. And, as you can see, makes it just fine around these objects. The pathfinding routine works really well to get around small objects or around large, square-shaped objects. Here's another place it does really well, sending a bunch of tanks across a bridge single file. It handles this remarkably well. Here, let's go back the other direction. Perfect. Now, let me show you the type of situation it performs poorly. Take this wall, for example. Because of its shape, the tank can't quite seem to make it around. However, after enough detours, it enters random mode for 10 cycles, then attempts to go back to the original course. And that actually works surprisingly well. In most cases, if you give the unit enough time, it'll eventually find the way. But it's really best to help the units move through complex terrain if you want them to get there quickly. Now, one little feature I added is that units can ask for help if they get too lost. Now, let me show you. I'll take this ATV here, and I'll tell it to go somewhere that is impossible for it to reach, like here. Now, I'll go back to my regular business and act as if I'd forgotten about it. And after a while, I'll get a notification. Help, I'm lost! So, like with all such notifications, you can just press the spacebar to take you to the location where that last notification came from, thus revealing your lost unit. And at this point, he just stopped and is awaiting help. Another major improvement over X2 and X3 is the enemy AI. For example, rather than sending every unit produced directly to your base, now they stay relatively close to their base, and they'll send out a major attack wave once enough units are produced, but at the same time, some units will stay behind to defend the base along with the sentry pods. Likewise, when you attack the enemy base, all available Protoid units will converge on you to help defend. Okay, let's talk about testing a bit. I kept my X16 on my desk with a standard composite television attached. This is mainly because I wanted to have the worst possible display device to make sure that the game is playable on that. And believe it or not, the game detects whether you're using VGA or composite and actually adjusts certain things accordingly. And this also led me to add a feature where you can press Shift-C to set high contrast mode for the text if it's a bit hard to read. Now, just for fun, I also created a monochrome version of the game, and other than the title screen, which was designed for 16 colors originally, the rest of the graphics are converted from the 256 color original source graphics over to 16 shades of gray. And so just looking here, you can see the monochrome graphics actually have more detail to them as a result. Also, a number of other bits of code were changed so that things like text and little dots on the minimap show up better on monochrome.
So one nice thing for me is that I didn't have to spend a lot of time and money developing a box and a printed user manual, since this game isn't going to be sold as a physical copy. And I think a lot of people really underestimate exactly how much time and money it can take to develop stuff like this. And so on the bright side, since I wasn't spending all that time, I could devote a little bit more time to working on the code instead of so much time working on things like this.
The user manual is a simple text file, and you can view it on the actual X16 itself by just typing edit userguide.txt, and there it is. It covers some of the basics of gameplay, and also has a frequently asked questions, and an appendix with all the keyboard shortcuts, which is very helpful, and a list of the resources needed to build things, health and damage, and stuff like that.
Anyway, I want to show you a couple of items that were planned but simply did not make it into this version, but they could certainly be added in a later release.
I wanted to have some sort of pop-up description of these buttons over here when you hover your mouse over them. And if you look at the sprite sheets, you'll see there are some flying units that didn't make it into the release, as well as a boat. One question people are likely to ask is if I plan to port this game to another platform like was done with Petsky Robots. Well, let's first talk about what system requirements would be needed. Now, first of all, look at the CPU visualizer, which is part of the Box16 emulator. You can see that the CPU hovers just around half and goes a bit over sometimes. This also played out well on the real hardware. For example, if I jumper the computer to 4 MHz mode, the game actually plays pretty well. I mean, I can notice it skips a frame every now and then. The average player might not even notice. But if I put it down to 2 MHz, then it becomes absolutely unplayable. Now, to be fair, the game tries to redraw the screen 60 times per second, and with some rework to the code, it could probably be designed to update at a slower frame rate, like 30 frames per second, or even less. So, which systems do I think would make good targets for this game? Obviously, any good low-hanging fruit would be other 6502-based systems. The two most logical targets would be the Mega 65 and the Phoenix. Both of these systems should have the horsepower to run a game like this. But what about an actual vintage computer? I think it's safe to rule out the Commodore 64, Atari 800, Apple II, etc. I think the Apple II GS could probably run this game if we had the right coder. The Super Nintendo, when paired with a mouse, could probably pull it off. And another possibility would be the Apple IIc Plus, since it runs at 4 MHz. But you'd need a Mockingboard because you have to have the timer chips it provides. And that's a really uncommon configuration. Likewise, the Laser 128EX2, which also runs at 4 MHz, could probably handle it.
I mean, obviously something like a decently fast MS-DOS computer, like 386SX, for example, could certainly handle running a game like this. The problem is it would be a monumental challenge for someone to convert all of that 6502 code over to 8088. Nevertheless, if someone would thinks they're up to the challenge, let me know and I will help in any way I can. For those of you without an X16, you can actually play this game for free by downloading the emulator, and I'll put a link down in the description field of where you can get both the emulator and the game. Another option would be to play the game on Steam. It's actually not up there yet at the time of filming, but hopefully it will be shortly. So check the description field for a Steam link as well. Another thing I'm going to put down there is some links to some YouTube playthrough videos. So for those trying to learn how to play the game, you could watch Dr. J struggle through and figure it out. But that's really it for this episode. I wasn't really planning on doing another X16 related video until next year, which would be 2024. But, you know, I spent most of 2023 working on this this game, and now that I'm finished, I just, like, I kind of have to tell the world about it because I kind of feel like this is my crowning achievement. It's, of the five games I've made now, this is definitely the one I'm the most proud of. And I feel like it kind of raises the bar on what can be done with an 8-bit system. But anyway, that's it for now. As always, thanks for watching.